Hello and welcome everyone to this Kidney Smart Coffee Talk hosted by the American Diabetes Association and DaVita. My name is Nuha El Sayed. I am an endocrinologist in Boston and I'm also the Vice President of Healthcare Improvement at the American Diabetes Association. Today I will be your host and we are joined by our smart expert, Christine Hare. Christine, can you tell us a little bit about yourself before we jump in?
Sure. My name is Christine Hare. I'm actually a registered dietitian and a certified renal specialist. I've worked with kidney patients for over 20 years. Currently, in the past 7 years, I've been teaching a class called Kidney Smart, which is it's a no-cost community education class open to anybody. And it's a really great way for people to learn more about kidney disease, whether they're already diagnosed with it or whether they're at risk for it, and really just how to better understand how to take care of themselves, delay the progression of CKD, and understand all the different treatment options that are out there.
Oh, what a wonderful class. Thank you for sharing that. So we are in March and it is Kidney Awareness Month. So we are here to say that kidneys are important. I mean, they filter blood, they remove waste products, and they regulate our salt and water balance. So kidneys are so important. And we also want to make sure that everybody knows that kidney disease is a very common thing. You know, 1 in 3 people who have diabetes have what we call chronic kidney disease. It is the ninth, unfortunately, it is the ninth cause of death in the United States. And every 24 hours, 170 people with diabetes start treatment for kidney failure. So it's a very, very important disease. This can be prevented. This can be treated. So that's why we're here to share with you, you know, some knowledge, answer your questions, and we will be having fun with you for 30 minutes. And we have people already joining us, oh, wow, from all over the world, not just the United States. So welcome. So Christine, we will kick this off with a few questions. And please, for our participants, if you have a question or a comment, just drop it in the comment section and I will do my best to bring it on to Christine, and I'll be pitching in and helping with any questions as well. But we already have a couple of questions. Christine, are you ready for them?
Absolutely. Let's dig in.
Excellent. Excellent. So the first question is, what role does blood glucose, or what people call sugar, management play in the overall kidney health?
It honestly plays a really vital role. And I, you know, not everyone always understands the relationship between diabetes and kidney disease. But, you know, if someone has diabetes and their blood sugars are elevated overall, just over time, it starts to really cause irreversible damage to the filters inside the kidneys. You know, there's normally we have millions of filters called nephrons, but over time, those elevations in blood sugars, it starts to damage not only the blood vessels inside the kidneys, but the nephrons themselves. And that's, it doesn't come back. It's not reversible. So learning how to manage your blood sugars is a huge, huge piece in our overall well-being, but definitely directly impacts our kidney health.
Thank you so much for sharing that. These are all very, very insightful questions. And, you know, so why is it so important to properly manage diabetes to avoid kidney failure through diet, exercise, and even medication?
It really is a little bit of everything, because again, it's that the irreversibility part is, I think, what's scary. I know when I have participants that come to a Kidney Smart class, the diagnosis of kidney disease, that's a scary thing. It's you know, this is something that your kidney function does not come back necessarily. And so early diagnosis with diabetes, understanding when you have it, and then really digging into how can I control this, as diabetes affects so many things, and we really want to preserve that kidney function. So it is kind of a multi-tiered approach. You know, definitely working with your medical team, your endocrinologists, or your primary care doctors, and figuring out the medical management. My background, of course, I'm a dietitian, so I'm a huge believer in the role that food plays in our choices. So in really encouraging people to understand what impacts their blood sugars. And everyone's a little bit different, but I think some of the common things we think about diabetes and food, you know, you think of, for example, you know, we think of sodas and cookies and candy. Absolutely, they have sugar in it. But I was walking down the cereal aisle the other day. I picked up a cereal that on the front of the box looked super healthy. You looked at the ingredients, 20 grams of added sugar, and that's just in one serving. So really understanding the food part of it and knowing what to look for on the food label can be key. And of course, the power of movement. Exercise is a huge piece of that blood sugar control. So really encouraging people to know themselves better and to know what to look for and how can I better manage my diabetes is a huge piece of keeping those kidneys healthy.
And Christine, right before we went live, we were chatting about this, and Marianne here in the comments actually is asking that particular question we were expecting. Is she's asking you as a dietitian to elaborate more on healthy diet in diabetes and chronic kidney disease. Can you give us a little bit of advice here?
And this, Marianne, that's such a great question. And probably the number one question I get asked in my Kidney Smart classes is, what am I supposed to eat with diabetes and kidney disease? Because when you look sometimes at a list of what to eat for diabetes and maybe something that your doctor may tell you not to eat for kidneys, sometimes they don't always agree all the way. The way I kind of big picture like to think about a diet for diabetes and the kidneys is it's a balanced diet. Also kind of thinking, how can I be, this sounds kind of silly, but how can I be gentler on my kidneys? We want them to keep working. So maybe managing the intake of certain nutrients to not make your kidneys have to work as hard. So number one, with the diabetes piece, you know, being consistent with your carbohydrates, understanding what foods maybe are impacting your blood sugar. So that is always piece number one. The other big nutrient that we see with diabetes and kidney management, of course, is sodium. And we were talking about this earlier too, how the two things that are in everything, it seems like, are sodium and sugar. But those are two big things that for anyone with diabetes and kidney disease or at risk for kidney disease, you really want to pay attention to that sodium. So looking at that on the label, most people do need to follow a lower sodium diet, generally somewhere in that range of 2000 milligrams a day or less. Where with kidney disease, a couple of other nutrients that come into play will be your protein intake. Particularly later stage kidney disease, we do typically want to be a little more moderate in our protein intake. Keep in mind that there's not one cookie cutter diet for everyone with kidney disease. I wish it was that easy, but we're all different. So really working with your team to kind of identify how much protein should I be eating. But in kind of a big picture, I would say with kidney disease, you're cutting back on your red meat intake and also especially cutting back on your more processed meats, things like your lunch meats, your hot dogs, bacon, sausage, many of those, not only is it the protein, but you're also getting sodium, an additional mineral that we think about with kidney disease, which is phosphorus. So those are the other two big ones that we think of with the kidneys would be your intake of dietary phosphorus, as well as potassium. Keep in mind, everyone is different. This is where a lot of confusion comes in with potassium in particular, is that many people will read that I'm not supposed to eat bananas if I have kidney disease. And because some people with CKD do have to be very careful with the amount of potassium they take in. And bananas, of course, have a lot of potassium. However, there are many other people with CKD that have completely normal potassium levels or may possibly need more of it. So really kind of understanding your labs, that's one thing I really encourage people to get a better understanding of what their blood work means so that they can kind of make informed choices and work with their healthcare team to see, you know, what do I need? Because we're all a little bit different. So it's a very long-winded answer, Marianne, but basically it's the sodium, the sugar, the protein, the potassium, the phosphorus are those main nutrients, but it's a building block and a balance for sure.
That was amazing because there was another question. I think, I mean, Christine, what I'm hearing is, you know, there's customization in this and it's yep. Really, you know, for each person, it may be different because your stage of disease could be different or you may not have kidney disease. You're trying to prevent it. And you may have other issues that need to be addressed. A question from Chandan, just to maybe make you finish this, is if there's any specific differences if you have micro or macro albuminuria in what you eat is one question that we got.
So that, you know, I wouldn't say a huge difference in what you're eating. The both of those would kind of come back to two things. Anytime you're spilling any kind of protein in the urine, we're going to be looking at, again, diabetes management, blood pressure control. And from a protein perspective, just watching how much and the type of protein. So but that is the protein in the urine, whether it's micro or macro. That's something that working with your endocrinologist, and if you have a nephrologist as well, how best to manage it. Some of this, of course, managed medically as well.
Yes, perfect. And we have, you know, there are some comments, and you know, there are people who are sharing with us that they cut down one can of soda a month, and you know, commenting on how they've improved, you know, their eating patterns. There's a question I may take, Christine, and you and I may actually do it. Like, how frequently should lab tests be checked for people with diabetes? That's one. And maybe it's a good time to tell people what to expect, you know. So what people with diabetes should expect is it's at least annually. That's the testing. So that's how frequent. And what you should expect being tested is a blood test and a urine test. The blood test we call EGFR. You can, you know, your clinical team can discuss with you. And the urine test is a urine albumin to creatinine ratio, UACR. So if you haven't gotten these tests, maybe, you know, prompt your team. And of course, based on these, there may be far more testing, but these are the, you know, the sort of the starting point. So that's a very, very good question. Thank you for asking. And then there is actually another question about Dr. Agarwal is mentioning that he read about concomitant medication used by people with diabetes affecting the kidneys. So that's a compounded question, Dr. Agarwal. There are medications that could cause kidney damage, so people have to be careful with, and that's for the clinical team to decide. There are medications that may be adjusted if you have kidney disease, so that's also for the clinical team to decide. And actually, if people have chronic kidney disease because of diabetes or because of high blood pressure and diabetes, there are groups of medications that can help, you know, like ARBs, ACE inhibitors, what we call SGLT2 inhibitors, or the new medications, non-steroidal MRAs. So, you know, the field of medication is a huge one, but thank you for bringing that up. And then, you know, there is a question about fasting, Christine. I know that for people who observe Ramadan, it's coming up this week. You know, if the diet advice is different, and Christine, you can go ahead and we can tag along.
You know, honestly, with fasting, it's always something I think important to talk with your clinical team about it if you're not going to be eating for long periods of time, particularly if you're requiring insulin or you're on other medications. The other piece from a kidney perspective, I always encourage, you know, if you are fasting, make sure you're still staying hydrated and drinking your water. I don't know if there's anything else you want to add from the fasting with a medical standpoint.
Yeah, so for fasting in general, there are strict guidelines about who can fast and who mm-hmm. should not fast. So I would check with my team, and it's best to, you know, check with your team ahead of time. So don't wait until you run into trouble and then stop fasting or decide to fast. Please do check with them ahead of time. And there are scientific and religious, you know, sort of accommodations that go through this for any of the faiths that fast, whether dry fasts or other forms of fast. So please do check with your team. And I can't agree more with you, Christine, for people with kidney disease, hydration. If you are clear to fast by your team during your non-fast hours, please keep up with your hydration. It's a big, big, big deal. So we have questions everywhere, Christine, and I'm going to bring some up. So there's one talking about the role. What role does high blood pressure play in overall kidney health?
So high blood pressure is another huge one. And you do see, and I don't know if we mentioned this earlier, but with kidney disease, the two biggest risk factors are diabetes, number one, and high blood pressure, number two. And many people with diabetes also may have high blood pressure. So it's kind of a double risk. Two out of three people with kidney disease, it's caused by high blood pressure, diabetes, or a combination of both. The analogy I always think of high blood pressure in the kidneys is almost like if you took your garden and you decided to water it with a fire hose or a power washer, you would never do that because that water would be coming so fast and furious that your soil would go everywhere, your plants would go everywhere. And that to me is how I think of high blood pressure and how it starts to affect those fragile filters in the kidneys. So that blood pressure control is right up there with diabetes control. Those are the two first things that we always talk about when we think about what can we do to help delay that progression of kidney disease is focus on that. Because the better that blood pressure is controlled, the less it will affect the kidneys moving forward. And similar to diabetes, it's kind of that multifactorial approach. It's partly your blood pressure medications, partly your diet, more specifically thinking more about that sodium intake, and also exercise and stress management. I never want to leave that one out there too, because that can have a huge impact on the blood pressure.
That's wonderful. And we have some comments in the chat, and you know, there are people talking about low blood pressure with dialysis, and people asking about, specific health issues. You know, I would highly advise that people would speak to their team, because all of these things can happen as you go through dialysis, whether it's cramping or low blood pressure. It may need medication adjustments, or throughout dialysis, they may make adjustments there. So Melly, please do speak with your mom's team. I think that would be the best way to go. Some of this would be very specific. There is a question about losing consciousness, syncope, and hypoglycemia or low glucose levels. It can absolutely happen in severe hypoglycemia. That's a question that's also in the chat. And that definitely warrants the, medical attention. And it may warrant that your regimen may be changed. We have more, a lot of questions and more comments and wonderful comments in the chat. There is a question, and you may be more versed than me in this. What are healthy alternatives to, so you spoke about sodium and glucose and sugar impact on health. What are the alternatives?
That's a great question. And it's a lot about a balance. So with sodium, I think when anyone's first put on a lower sodium diet, many people are like, there's not much taste to it. And we still want the food to taste good. So I'm a huge fan of looking at some of those alternatives, and maybe, for example, making your own salad dressings or making your own marinades. There's a ton of different commercial products that are just blends of herbs and spices, something like a Mrs. Dash, for example, which has come a long way. There's multiple flavors of it, or just making your own, particularly like some fresh basil, some rosemary, whether it's fresh or a dried herb, mixing it with some olive oil and vinegar, you can make a terrific salad dressing, or use it as a marinade to maybe prepare your chicken or fish that way. It can be a really great way to still have a lot of flavor without the sodium. And looking for lower alternatives for the carbohydrates, I found recently they have a new product, like a hearts of palm, makes rices and pastas that are actually made out of the hearts of palm that are much lower in carbohydrates and are actually pretty low in sodium too. So there's a lot of new products on the market. So sometimes it's just taking some of your favorite dishes and tweaking them a little bit. And always remembering, and I think this is what it comes back to a lot with nutrition, is portion matters. So sometimes you can have a little bit of your favorite thing that still has sodium in it, but still make out overall a well-rounded lower sodium meal. So then that's, again, we're looking at the food label and looking at the serving size and kind of balancing out those plates makes a big difference.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And questions keep coming. There's a question about, this is more of a general question. What best drug we would recommend for people with diabetes? That's a question that is hard to answer generally, because the management of diabetes is very person specific. So when someone walks into my clinic, we do this best medication approach based on a lot of things, based on what health issues you have, what kind of risk we need to reduce, if people have weight issues or no weight issues. Is the medication available? Is the medication something you can buy, or if you have insurance, can your insurance company cover? So that question is very, very person centric, and it would be best to do that, with your clinician. But we at the American Diabetes Association, we actually have a way that sort of guides people to do that, and we call it the guidelines. And there are people who are asking about if there are any, if there's any way you could know that you have diabetes without a lab test. Symptoms can happen, but diabetes can be a silent disease, and it could go on for a long time. So we encourage people to get their regular visits to their clinicians, then primary care clinicians and others. But obvious ones is when people find that they are very thirsty, they're losing weight, they're very hungry all the time, they're getting infections all the time. and they're peeing all the time. That's a very common thing that may happen in diabetes, but also other diseases may they make this a little less obvious. And I mean, it looks like, people, oh my goodness, like, oh, we have even wonderful suggestions in the chat about, some kidney crushers, Christine, you have some help here in the chat. And there's a question is, what are, some FAQs about diabetes and kidney disease, that you hear often, Christine?
Oh gosh, honestly, we hit some of them already with, what do I eat and where it is. It's a very individualized approach, but those are some of the key nutrients that we discussed. The protein, of course, the phosphorus, the potassium, as well as our big ones, the sodium and the sugar. So looking at those and really kind of individualizing that approach with your provider is a big piece. And kind of to build on something that you were just saying, Dr. El Sayed, about the diagnosis of diabetes is, the other thing I always tell people, if you have a family history of diabetes in your family, definitely, that's a really big reason also to make sure that you're getting your blood work checked annually just to see how your sugars are running, checking that hemoglobin A1C, particularly with type 2 diabetes. So many people, when they're maybe finally diagnosed, they may have had diabetes for years, kind of underlying and not knowing it, may already have some kidney damage. So that I am a huge proponent of staying on top of your health and making sure that you're getting your blood work done and seeing your primary care doctor or a community clinic annually or as often as you're able to monitor for all of these things.
Yeah, this is great. And there are some questions that I always get, like, what are the risk factors for the developing diabetic kidney disease? And I always tell my patients, there are things we can't change, cannot mm-hmm. change, which is our family history, to your point, Christine, mm-hmm. our ethnicity. But there are things we can change. And just to sum it all up, it's high blood pressure, high glucose numbers, high cholesterol, smoking, and excess weight. So these we can do, something about. And how do we prevent kidney disease from happening? Making healthy choices, improving blood glucose. I'm going to say it again, improving blood pressure. I'm going to say it one more time. Very, very important. And okay, fine. So now I have, diabetic kidney disease one now. I'll say it again. Healthy choices, blood glucose numbers should be better. Blood pressure. Discuss medications. There are medications now that we can use for diabetic kidney disease. They are in our guidelines. Everyone should be on what they need to be on. And I think we have a moment to take one more question here. Sweeteners, artificial sweeteners, Christine, any quick comments before we wrap up?
That's a really good question. That's another common one I get a lot. I think most of your artificial sweeteners are generally recognized as safe with kidney disease. I'm a big believer, if you can, trying to limit the added sugars and added sweeteners as much as possible and trying to look for ways to minimize that. Not that they're not safe, but it's something I try not to go overboard with. And I think that's always a good thing. Looking for just alternatives, like, for example, instead of doing sweetened beverages or artificially sweetened beverages, one of my favorite things to do is maybe adding lemons or limes or infusing your water with other fruits or vegetables like mint or cucumber to get that natural flavor out. But in regards overall, the sweeteners are generally recognized as safe. Just again, everyone has different side effects and symptoms, so just monitor yourself and how you do with them.
Yes, thank you. And we're getting a lot of lightheadedness comments. So I will say it again, please, when you do have these, you do need to speak to your clinical team. People are mentioning that they are on diabetes medication. So by all means, yes, this could warrant that it needs to be changed. It could be something else. So best thing is to get this assessed by your clinical team. And you shouldn't just be disregarding it or assuming you should be feeling that way. No, there could be a reason, and this reason could be reversible and it could be managed. So please do check with your team. We have Malik making a comment about the guidelines. We appreciate it, Malik. Thank you. And we try to make it better and better every day. There was a question. I think there was a comment about the risk of diabetic kidney disease or chronic kidney disease, which we use interchangeably. If you're controlled, then the risk is lower. That's why Christina and I are here to advocate for that. So the risk is lower. you know, they did drop, the American Diabetes Association and DaVita did drop a lot of resources here. So, you know, I encourage you to take a look at them. These are very well thought resources and information for you to use. Any last words of wisdom, Christine, before we wrap this up?
You know, honestly, just if any of you, you know, have chronic kidney disease or at risk for it, just small changes, you know, like Dr. El Sayed mentioned, you know, there's some things we can't control, but there is a lot that we can. And one of those is just really gaining the knowledge that we can empower ourselves to make those good decisions. You know, working with your team, knowing your numbers so that you can ask those informed questions to better help keep yourself and your kidneys as healthy as possible. And if you are in the United States, the Kidney Smart class is nationwide. I know they're going to drop a link to it in the comments. Please sign up. It's great for anyone already with kidney disease or people at risk for it as well. I think that there's a lot to learn.
Thank you so much, Christine. This has been very informative. Whenever we talk about dietary interventions, you know, it is a very hot topic, and it's very, very important for people with kidney disease and diabetes. So thank you so much for making the time. Thank you so much for engaging with us and for all the wonderful comments, questions, and insights. You know, we hope you have a wonderful, wonderful rest of your day.
Thank you, everyone.